Welcome to the Growth Whisperers Podcast with Brad Giles and Kevin Lawrence. In this podcast, we talk about everything that relates to building enduring great companies. Not just your typical build and flip, but ones that endure for decades and generations, because we get a kick out of that. We'll be digging into some interesting discussions today around obsession, which we'll get to in a minute. But before, Brad, how are things in your world, and what is your word or phrase of the day?
Things are extraordinary in my world, and my word of the day, immature. That's not what you thought I was going to say, is
immature.
It?
Immature.
Immature. Immature. That's, yeah. So I saw this.
Is that the Australian version of immature? Yeah.
You know, there's another version that's Australian, which tells you which creek you can go and jump in, but I won't go there. So immature is my word of the day. Thank you. And what I'm thinking in particular, I saw this kind of thesis: when we deal with people in a leadership setting, as we do, leadership team members, etc., they got problems. They got, you know, everyone's got their own stuff going on, and all of the personalities that the personality traits that we observe that are negative, they all kind of distill up to be one single thing, which is they're acting immature. And so,
interesting.
And so, yeah, you got someone who's narcissistic, or you got someone who's not got a high enough EQ perhaps to be able to interact in a respectful manner, or they're butting in, or whatever it is, or they're picking on people's accents, or I don't know, whatever it might be.
Nice how you slid that in there. That was awesome.
I don't understand. But the point that I'm making is just thinking about the people, and it's like, we can just call it immaturity. That's my word.
Interesting. Interesting. Well, my word is mastery. You know, last night we had dinner with some friends, and one of the couple made dinner like mind-blowing. Like this he could be a master chef. I would put the dinner up against almost any dinner I have probably ever had.
Wow.
In terms of, yeah, it was unfreaking believable. Like, but it's master. He's obviously put a lot of time into it, and you know, and a lot of energy into it, and a lot of care into it. But it was a masterful dinner. It was just shockingly, like, just unbelievably good, which I didn't know he was that great of a cook or almost like a chef. It was beautiful. But it's this mastery and focusing on doing something and the care and the intention to do it. And it was just, you know, when you see one of your friends do something like that, and we see it at work and we see mastery everywhere, but just as fresh in my mind and my taste buds from that dinner last night, just, you know, absolute mastery. So mastery and maturity are kind of the two themes here today. And yeah, awesome. Well, let's dig in, you know, to another term of obsession, which, you know, I would suggest that, you know, my friend was probably very obsessed with making a spectacular dinner. It was like obsession. And I would suggest that, you know, obsession would probably lead to mastery in a lot of cases. So,
Mate, hang on. What was the dinner? Like, you can't just leave it hanging like that. What was for dinner?
Like, I could say that we had chicken and salad.
Cool.
And but it was a salad with this dressing that was mind-blowingly good.
That's good.
But there was this pasta. It was a special pasta noodle I've never had, like a hollow spaghetti, that was cooked absolutely perfectly al dente with this grilled roasted chicken on it that I don't know why it was so good. And then this love sauce over top that he had simmered for hours. So it was like, it was chicken and pasta, and it was Michelin restaurant quality. It was just unbelievable.
Yeah. All right. Let's talk about a session.
Okay. Well, yeah, I'm almost obsessed with that dinner. It was so good.
Seems that way.
So, yeah, it was just, you know, I love mastery. I love seeing someone do beautiful work and being a part of it. So today the theme is obsession, and how obsession is really powerful if directed to the right things. And obsession, and you know, in our last episode, we talked about Stephen Covey's time management matrix. And you know, if obsession is put on unimportant things, it obviously is not a healthy thing. But if it's put on really important, meaningful things to you, it is an incredibly powerful force. And really, we looked up the definition of obsession. It's an idea or thought that continually occupies or intrudes on a person's mind. So there's a lot of negative obsessions people can have. We're talking obsession about something positive, and in particular, your goals. And it could be your purpose or your BHAG or something you want to do with your family or your friends or your health or who knows what. But yeah, it's channeling your creative mind and your energies towards something that's very, very, very meaningful to you. And, you know, it just relates on you just working hard at it and continuing to try things. And, you know, we were talking before the show, but when we look at people who achieve great things, there's usually a great deal of obsession.
And what's interesting as you're saying that is thinking about the inverse. What's the opposite?
Yeah.
Okay. So if you don't have an obsession about big goals, well, there's a very good chance that your team think that you just don't care. And if the team think that you just don't care, then there's a very good chance that will lead them to not care. And then this is this kind of downward spiral loop of, well, I don't care, so why should I care?
Right. It's like if those big goals are something over there on a wall, but you don't ever talk about it or you don't constantly talk about it or bring it up.
Yeah.
You're right. They're going to say, well, yeah, they're interesting, but there's no energy there. So I'm not going to put any energy there. That's a very, very good point. And I think that's what it is that if we connect a lot of energy to it, it's contagious to other people around us. It's also dangerous if you're obsessing about the wrong things.
Yeah.
Like if you're obsessing about, you know, politics, and politics aren't really that relevant in your business, that's a distraction. As I talked about on the show last week, you know, if you're obsessing about stuff on social media and, you know, and learning about things that really don't matter to you, that can be a waste of time. And sometimes it can be bad for your brain too.
Yeah.
To be obsessed about things that aren't important or just purely distraction.
There's an entrepreneur here in Australia, a friend of mine named Naomi Simpson. She's got a company called Red Balloon, and they provided, she really changed the market a bit, moving from giving gifts, which were things or products, into giving gifts which were experiences. And she aggregated experiences from across Australia, you know, hot air ballooning or rafting or whatever it might be, or massages. And so she turned them into gifts that you could give. And so she obsessed over this goal of giving 2 million experiences. Yeah. And in when you walk into their office, when you used to walk into their office, they had this massive counter which said, how many experiences have we provided? And so everyone knew that she cared about that.
Yes.
Everyone knew. Yeah. It was hard not
to. And it's a great example. So not only was it a big goal, but there was active energy and obsession going towards it, which helps it to come true. Yeah, it's fascinating. I think about the, you know, we looked up the data before on the story of Thomas Edison and inventing the light bulb. And we've heard the story that, you know, he tried 10,000 times or failed 10,000 times trying to create it. And there's a quote from him is that, you know, I didn't fail 10,000 times. I just figured out 9,999 things that didn't work.
Yeah.
And there's lots of truth there, but you think about the amount of obsession someone would have to continue to push to find ways to make that happen when it seems all but impossible. And it's interesting. And we looked up the data, and from one of the university sites that seemed quite credible. It said in a period of 1878 to 1880, Edison and his associates worked on at least 3,000 different theories to develop an efficient incandescent light bulb. And I've heard other stories about specific experiments. So there's probably many experiences or many experiments within those 3,000 theories. And, you know, that's I'm sure that probably that the 10,000 number could be true. But the idea of it is it's unrelenting focus and testing and trying to make that goal happen. And it works. And it's energizing to be around, too.
Yeah.
Especially when they're obsessed about positive things.
Yeah. Yeah. Because people respect what you inspect. Okay. So if, as a leader, you spend your time on one particular thing more than others, well, people think to themselves, well, they care. It must be important. So if it's the big goals, there is great cause, great reason to focus on those big goals and not hundreds, but you know, the few over the many that really matter. This is what really matters. Right. Sending that message gets people aligned behind where you want to go.
Yeah. And it explains why some people, you know, might have the same ideas, but one comes out and achieves it and others don't. Yeah. It's just time thing. So in my place in Vancouver, I have a coffee table that is born from this concept of obsession. And it's a story about Henry Ford. And I think it was in the 30s, back when Ford was, when V8 engines were coming to be. And V8 engines had been invented, but they were multiple chunks of steel that had to be bolted together. In modern language, there was the block, and then the heads had to be bolted on with all these moving parts. And it was hard and expensive to make. And Henry Ford was obsessed himself with, you know, economical transportation for the masses, right? Part of his vision was that, you know, every man, and we had the words women because it was men that were driving in those days, but should be able to have access to God's great pastures and explore the world through his transportation. So when he decided that the V8 engine was going to be very important to Ford and a competitive advantage, but he, in his mind, believed it needed to be made out of one cast block because then it was cheap and fast to make. So very efficient, drive the cost down. And his engineers couldn't do it. And finally, he had a bit of a temper tantrum and a rant. And as the story goes, he said, and he bangs the table, "I will have one. I must have one. And if you aren't the people to develop it, some other men will. So I don't want to see you again and don't come back until you have made my V8 engine out of one chunk of steel." And, you know, you can imagine in the days, and it might have been a little bit rough, but 18 months later, they came up with the final working version of what's called the Ford Flathead V8. It's a legendary motor. And I have one of these motors in my place where it's broken down and made to look nice, but it's the full working motor with a glass top on it. And I just, you know, when I heard that story, and I'm a car nut by nature, but it reminded me of like at that point in time, it wasn't possible, but he took a stand that it will happen. And he was obsessed because he needed it for his and it gave Ford a notable competitive advantage. But the main thing is, because of the way it's built, it's super cheap and easy to make it scale. Anyway, just a great story about how that obsession pays off when someone is willing to commit to it and get other people lined up to get it done.
Yeah. Switching gears a little bit, there's a sport in Australia, most popular sport, called Australian Rules Football. It's not rugby, but it doesn't matter. It's played with a ball on a pitch. And there's a football club called Richmond. It's in a Melbourne suburb. And in 2009, the main guy there, Brendan Gale, set a big heritageous goal that within 10 years, they would win 3 premierships. They would have $20 million in cash, because at that time they were $25 million in debt or something. And they would have 100,000 members. And I think at that point they had like 60 or 70,000 members. And it was leaked to the press. And within days he was on the football shows having to defend his BHAG because it was so audacious and so crazy.
Yes. Anyway,
because to give you an idea, winning 3 premierships, it hadn't really been done since the 1960s. And so it was very audacious on multiple fronts. Anyway, so he focused on it and focused and focused and focused and focused and did it. And so a couple of years ago, they got that. They won their 3 premierships, which was simply unheard of in the modern era. I think they had like $25 or $24 million positive cash going from, you know, minus 25. And they had like 108,000 members And that was because he focused on it and he just kept focusing on it.
Yeah. Shocking. Like many of the great things that have been invented in this world, like many of the great accomplishments that have happened, people are just committed and they push through the resistance and persist and persist. First they believe, and then they persist and persist and bring all their creativity to finding a way. Yeah, another real simple version is one of the companies that I work with, very successful company, worked with them for more than a decade. When I first started, I think they were a couple, you know, like maybe 30 million in revenue, somewhere in that range. And, you know, the CEO has a vision of hitting different levels of achievement. And as football fans, American football fans, you know, in America, they have this thing called Super Bowls, right? The big football competition, kind of like the football version of the World Cup for what is also called football, but in America, they call it soccer.
Yeah, we call it soccer too.
Yeah, and same in Canada. We call it soccer. But so what we have, and I don't have them with me right now, I can show you, but basically that we were going to call our Super Bowls hitting 100 million in revenue, 250, 500, and a billion. And so I have my 100 million ring, which is like a Super Bowl style ring. And I got my 250 million ring. And, you know, we had a meeting recently and we're all rallied around those milestones that we will hit. And we had a meeting recently and, you know, they hit, I think it was four something US. When you convert it to Canadian dollars, it's over 500. So I'm saying, hey, I joke, hey, well, we got the Canadian, you know, 500 Super Bowl ring. I go, yeah. What's your football competition called? I go, well, we got, ours is called the Grey Cup. He goes, yeah, well, we didn't get a Super Bowl, but we got our Grey Cup because it's, you know, the Canadian version of football. And you know, they would have hit 500. But the point of it is, all of us are like, and the ring is a token celebration. But it's, we're obsessed with getting to the 500 and then the billion. Because like, why not? And it's a purpose-led company. They give a deep crap about their team and everything else. But we've got these little anchors to help us stay focused on our way to the BHAG. And it's fun and it's engaging and we talk about it a lot.
Yeah, yeah. There's a company that I work with that comes to mind when you say that. The leader was absolutely focused on having multiple services without going into who it is. Mm. So some people focus on the niches or niche, and others focus on trying to go wide. Well, he was focused on trying to go wide. And the problem was that meant that they weren't really awesome at anything. There was one thing they were pretty good at, and that's a trap for many, many people. But
yes,
but to his credit, he focused on saying, we want to get to this point, which is a certain amount of total revenue. That meant that we can overcome the width. And through the, I guess 5 years ago, through the there was some pretty tough times around here. You know, we were losing millions of dollars a year in that business. And he kept on focusing and kept on focusing and adapted, came out of it, and did it, and has now kind of come through and is just getting stellar results. So it doesn't mean that you should not focus on the niche. That's not what I'm saying at all. It was about his relentless focus on building this kind of multifaceted business.
Right. And the learning and the testing and all that that comes as a result when you do that versus just letting happen. Because in many ways, you're having to defy gravity.
Pardon me. Sounds like you're defying sickness there.
I'm defying, exactly. So the question really for us to think about is, you know, are you obsessing enough about your most important goals? That's really what it is. Are you putting energy, time towards your most important things? Number one. And then number two, you know, are you potentially obsessing about things that aren't most important? Right? Are you thinking too much about some things that maybe don't matter most? And really, you know, obviously we know there's a real danger in focusing on obsessing about negative things. because we get caught up in it. There's also an energy to focusing too much on negative things. So yeah,
well, put another way, are you not paying enough attention? Are you ignoring the big goals?
Yes. Yeah, you're ignoring. Are you paying attention to? Or you're fully giving the right amount of obsession that is needed to make them happen.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's the thing. And whether it's goals or at work or in life, you know, are you focused on, you know, obsessed with finding ways to have the best relationship you can with your partner or your children or your parents, if your parents are still around? You know, are you really spending the time thinking about and then acting upon thoughts to drive towards the things that matter most? Which goes back to, you know, even we talked about last episode a bit, is really having clear goals so you know what matters most, and then channeling enough time and energy and thought and activity to those things.
So why the greatest leaders obsess over their goals, that's kind of the podcast episode. It's because if they don't, the people think that you just don't care. If they don't, and this could be BHAGs, big, hairy, audacious goals, this could be any of the big things that you're trying to, the big goals that you're trying to achieve. If you don't obsess over them, the people think that you just don't care, and then they just kind of drift into the grayness of life. Good chat, Kev.
Well said. Well said.
Good chat. All right. So hopefully we've either answered that question or stimulated you to obsess over the big goals that you've already set. And to go back and obsess and to reiterate that with your team. So this has been the Growth Whisperers podcast. My name is Brad Giles. The other chap with the cough that you've been hearing is Kevin Lawrence in Kelowna, BC, I do believe it is, in Canada. And you can find Kevin at the website lawrenceandco.com. You can find me at evolutionpartners.com.au. We've both got newsletters and interesting stuff that we're always talking about. Also, you can find us on YouTube. Don't forget to like us there and to rate the podcast. We would certainly appreciate that. Hope you've enjoyed the show. Do have yourself a great week.